So I write this series called New York 101, where I explain the infrastructure that we take for granted and probably don't think about very often. And so I'm going to just take you through a very high-level overview of how New York City gets its water. This is something that David touches upon in his book, but it's an interesting little prism through which to think about sort of water issues. So, okay, does everybody know what this is? What is it? Okay. Do you know what it stands for? So this blue symbol actually represents the wooden pipes that were part of the city's first water system that was built in the early 1800s. So this is, imagine New York City in the 1790s. You know, the city was just becoming sort of a banking center, and you know, there was an influx of, you know, more and more people were moving into the city, and until this point, you know, the citizens had been relying on wells and natural springs to get their water. But without a sewage system, the water system was, the drinking water was mixing in with human waste. There were dead animal carcasses. There were just chemicals that were kind of spilling out from the businesses and other other factories and manufacturing centers. And so in the 1790s, a man by the name of Aaron Burr said, I will create a system using hollowed out tree trunks to deliver fresh water from the Bronx River to citizens of Manhattan, which seems like a very noble gesture, but he was really using it as a front to start his own bank to rival Alexander Hamilton's. And so he convinced the legislature to let him pocket the proceeds and build the system, which was a disaster. And so, you know, it really only served a, you know, sort of a small population. And oh, the other thing I forgot to mention is that people were dying of yellow fever and cholera, and so disease was spreading, and also the city was repeatedly catching on fire. And so it wasn't until the Great Fire of 1835 when the city sort of decided to take this a little bit more seriously. So in the 1830s, the city began building the first of the three water systems that we use today. So that's the Croton system, which is about 40 miles north of the city. And so, you know, if you've ever walked on the High Bridge over the Harlem River, that beautiful aqueduct, that was part of the infrastructure that brought water from the Croton River to the Bronx in the 1840s. But, you know, the city kept expanding, more and more people were arriving, and it just kept getting harder to protect that land around the water to keep it fresh. So, and clean. And so the city eventually started expanding and looking further north, about 125 miles northwest of the city, and to create the Delaware and the Catskill systems. And the beauty of the system is that all three of these systems that are actually separate all kind of are interconnected. So, but today, almost all the water that we drink comes from the Delaware and Catskill systems. And if you can see, there are two aqueducts that are like straws that draw water and deliver it to New York City. Now, like anything that's a century old, some of this infrastructure is starting to is starting to show its age. And actually one of the aqueducts, the Delaware, has been leaking about 20 million gallons a day for the last couple of decades. So that is on a very long list of projects that the DEP is looking at when it is thinks about, you know, the future of this system. And they're gonna have to shut that down and in a couple of years, and actually they'll rely more on the Croton system and the Catskill system while that's happening. But the system is an engineering marvel, especially for its time. So when you think about it, every day, like more than 1 billion gallons of water is delivered to New York City every day, almost entirely by the force of gravity. So if you imagine this is built in the 1920s, right? And so you have that the Ashokan Reservoir, this is the Catskill Aqueduct, by the way, it's 92 miles long, and it plunges 1,100 miles underneath the Hudson River, which is incredible when you think about it. And you know, when it was built, you know, everybody compared it to, you know, the aqueducts in Rome and Greece, but it was built with free and fair labor. And so if you look at pictures of the campsites, this is, the DEP actually has a really terrific archive of photographs from the building of all of these, you know, reservoirs and lakes and aqueducts. And so if you look at, this is one of the campsites for the workers. And they were like little villages. They had set up schools. They had, they created police forces. And workers who were mostly Irish immigrants had an 8-hour work day. So, you know, on one hand, this was a great job creator, and it was also sort of, you know, a sign of, you know, American ambition. On the downside of it, and this is something that David really does a great job of talking about in his book, is, you know, bringing mountain water to New York City, you know, sort of was not without conflict. And so, you know, when we talk about the tension between New York City and upstate, a lot of that comes from when New York City was sort of taking over land upstate and literally drowning towns like Cannonsville, New York. There were thousands of people who were displaced, and even more people, more dead people, who were dug up and then reburied because they were moving entire cemeteries, and they also, you know, rerouted railroad tracks. I mean, this is really disruptive. And of course, there was strong resistance, and there were a lot of court battles, and even neighboring states. I mean, New York and New Jersey have had a long simmering feud about, you know, who has the right to the water. And one of these cases, you know, bubbled up to the Supreme Court because New Jersey didn't think that New York should have access to some of the tributaries in the Delaware River. And the Supreme Court said, yes, they do. And so they continued to sort of take over land. But all of that is so that New York City can have clean drinking water. So the Catskill watershed in the Delaware, that area up there is, you know, it's like, also like the Colorado River, you know, the largest consumer of all of this water is furthest from the source. So, you know, it begins in these snow-packed mountains in the Catskills. But that area around there that has 19 reservoirs and 3 controlled lakes is heavily regulated. And so 40% of the land up there, it's about 1 million acres, which is about the size of Delaware. And 40% of that land is owned by the state or the city or municipalities or some, you know, sort of non nonprofits or land conservancies. And so the area up there is heavily regulated. Like farmers have to, you know, create manure sheds so that, you know, the runoff doesn't, you know, get into the water, and local towns have to cover their salt sheds so that that doesn't leach into the water, and they also have very strict guidelines about like wastewater treatment. And so, you know, the DEP engineers I talk to always talk about how New York water is protected and treated at the source rather than at the end of the tap. And so that's sort of a big part of why the water is so great. So another brilliant feature of the system is that engineers can actually draw water from specific parts of a reservoir where they know it's the cleanest. And one thing that's important to know about the Catskill and Delaware watersheds is that it's unfiltered. And so New York City is only one of about five large cities in the country that isn't required by the EPA to filter this water, which is a very expensive process. And I'll tell you a little bit about how they treat it instead. But there are, you know, there's a small army of field scientists who are constantly monitoring, the water quality and temperature and, you know, microbes. And they've built robotic buoys that are automatically, you know, constantly sort of transmitting data so that these engineers can sort of find out where the cleanest water is. Because one of the things that can affect treatment of unfiltered water is something that's called turbidity, which is like the cloudiness of the water. So, you know, if there's a big rainstorm, like little clay particles and silt can like, you know, sort of muddy up the water, and that can inhibit treatment. You know, so they're worrying about a lot of things up there. That, you know, of course they're worrying about terrorists, but they're also worrying about bird poop. You know, these are very inviting environments for migrating birds and geese who like to hang out on these lakes. And so, you know, DEP is, you know, if you read their annual reports, they talk about like how they're like either chasing them away, like running after them to scare them off, or putting up netting or shooting off air cannons. And so, you know, they're also worrying about climate change, obviously, because that is, you know, when you think about that, also not only affects the quality of the water, but also it affects the water, the levels of the reservoirs. And actually, if you're curious about the reservoir levels, the New York Times actually prints it in the Metropolitan Almanac every day. Still, I checked. So the way that the water is treated is by ultraviolet radiation. So, you know, it's treated with chlorine, but that can create these harmful byproducts when it mixes with organic compounds. So as a supplement, what they do is it goes through the largest ultraviolet treatment facility in the world, which is in Westchester. And in this facility, there are 56 of these large tanks that slow the water down so that it's traveling at the right speed. And inside each one of these, there are 56 of these tanks. And inside each one is a long quartz tube that's full of light bulbs. And they're constantly checking the light bulbs, and they have little monitors that let the engineers know if even one of the bulbs has gone out. So, and those are all tucked inside, and so when the water passes through, the ultraviolet radiation sort of zaps, you know, the bacteria. And so every day, about 1 billion gallons of water gets treated here. So it can take 12 weeks to a year for this water to wind its way down to the city. And its last stop is at Hillview Reservoir, which is about, it's in Yonkers, it's about 300 feet above sea level. And it's like a giant bathtub that holds enough water for New York City for one day. So this bathtub is connected to three tunnels that act like drains. And the force of the water, because it's at that precise altitude, the force of the water is enough to push that water all the way to Staten Island and to the sixth floor of most buildings. I think there's only two places in the city where that requires electric pumps. And so in Hillview Reservoir, I met one of the engineers, the chief engineer, who I don't think has ever talked to anybody about his job before, who, you know, talked about how he's the unsung hero and this whole team is there 365 days a year and even on Thanksgiving and Christmas, and they're worrying about our water, so you don't have to. And so they're constantly calling up to Kensico, which is the reservoir just above it, to make sure that enough water is coming down, because they literally open these valves and send water down to Hillview, because they have to make sure that the reservoir level is at a certain height so that it can create that pressure to send it all the way down to Staten Island. And they're also adding things like chlorine and phosphoric acid and sodium hydroxide, which disinfects it, also raises the pH levels, and it also creates a protective coating on the pipes so that it doesn't, so that it prevents metals like lead from leaching into the water. And until recently, the city only had two tunnels that delivered water to the city, and tunnels number one and two were built in 1917 and 1936, respectively, and neither has ever been turned off or inspected. So in the 1950s, the city decided that they actually tried to shut one of them down, and one of the giant valves started to crack, and so they stopped that. And so they decided, okay, we should probably build a third water tunnel, because if one of the two were to cease functioning, New York City would be in trouble. So they decided to do it in 1950, but they didn't start digging until 1970, and they're still not done. And you know, this is not a glamorous, you know, infrastructure project. The mayor doesn't get to, you know, sort of cut the ribbon at the end of it. There's no ticker tape parade. And it's also really expensive. It's gonna be about $6 billion by the time it's done. So it's one of the most expensive infrastructure capital projects in the city's history. So interest from mayor to mayor hasn't been even. Mayor Bloomberg was very adamant and wanted to finish it, and so he did put a lot of money into it. Bill de Blasio was not so interested in doing it, and actually it was only after the Times reported that he was not allocating money for the project that he sort of chipped in and said, oh, that was a misunderstanding. We care about water. The city said that it'll be finished. I mean, right now it is bringing water to Manhattan and the Bronx, but what needs to be finished is the part that is going to deliver water to Brooklyn and Queens, where more than half the population lives. And the city says that that's going to be done in the mid 2020s, but we'll see. This system, just downstate alone, costs $140 million to operate on a day-to-day basis, and just downstate. And we pay for this through water and sewer fees. And over the next few years, the city is going to put in about $3.5 billion dollars to fix that leaking aqueduct and also other water mains. You know, there's almost 7,000 miles of water mains underneath the city. Every time you stand on a street, there's at least one underneath you. And they're all, almost all made of iron and steel. So, and has anyone seen these little silver boxes on the street that say DEP on them? Does anyone know what they are? Anyone? Anyone? they are water sampling stations. There are about 1,000 of them around the city. And inside each one is a little sink. And every day, inspectors from the DEP go out and they select 50 that they're going to visit. And then they test for things like, you know, they do some testing on the sidewalk right then and there. And that, you know, they're checking for, you know, pH levels and E. coli, which could, you know, be a sign of a sewage problem. And then they take these samples and then they, you know, put water in it and then wrap it up with a little barcode like you would, like your blood test at the hospital. And then they send that sample to the lab. And they're conducting, like, I mean, almost 500,000 tests on these waters because they've got to comply with state regulations, but also the EPA regulations. You know, and they're testing for very complicated sounding chemicals that you've never heard of or can't pronounce. You know, the EPA sort of sets these 90 contaminants that, you know, that have been spotted and have been deemed harmful, and they, you know, so then the city is required to test for those. And every year the city puts out a water quality report. It's very enjoyable reading. I highly recommend it. And they put out all of their findings in a very detailed report. This one last year's just came out, so hot off the presses. So they're also testing for lead and things like that, but that's really more of an issue with the service lines that the city is very sure to mention that they do not control. So these are the service lines that connect from the water mains to like your building. So why does New York City have great bagels and pizza? So our water is what they call soft. You know, it doesn't contain as many natural chemicals that would give it like an electric charge, like calcium or iron. And this is the softness that gives your soap a very nice lather in the shower. So in addition to the work, of course, that the DEP is doing to protect the watershed and to, you know, to protect water at the source, New York also has great geology, and it's actually the geology of the Catskill Mountains, which is mostly limestone rock, which doesn't, there's very little limestone rock, which contains calcium, which can taste bitter. And so, according to taste professionals, we have an ideal balance of calcium and dissolved minerals. But we drink only a tiny, tiny, tiny portion of the water that comes through here. Most of it ends up in washing machines, it ends up in fire hydrants, or down the toilet. And with that, I turn it over to David, who will enlighten us about the Colorado River.
Thank you, Emily. Down the toilet. All right. The Colorado starts up here in the Rocky Mountains outside of Boulder, up in Estes Park. And it flows 1,400 miles through the Grand Canyon, the famous Grand Canyon, it or its tributaries flow through seven states, and then it ends in the upper end of the Gulf of California in Mexico, or at any rate, it's supposed to. This, we had to the artist had to redo this map because this part of the river doesn't actually exist. The Colorado doesn't get all the way to the end anymore. It hasn't for decades, except for once a couple of years ago. So it's sort of an ideal subject because it's long enough at 1,400 miles to cover a lot of territory, and yet it's short enough that you can follow it, and we use it all up. So whatever was in it is gone. I wanted to use my laser pointer. This is not very far into Mexico. This is a town called San Luis Rio Colorado. It's named for the Colorado River, and the Colorado River, when the bridge was built, the Colorado River flowed under it, but it doesn't anymore, and people often complain about having to pay 6 pesos in toll to cross this bridge. And some of them will actually drive down through the sand, and why not? I started out on an airplane with a woman from the Environmental Defense Fund, and she had told me that the best way to see a river was from any water system was to see it from the air. And then this pilot was part of a kind of a cool group called Light Hawk, which it's volunteer pilots in their airplanes. They volunteer to fly for a variety of environmental causes and environmental organizations. And just the week before our flight, a Light Hawk flight had taken some black-footed ferrets from Fort Collins to deposit them near the Grand Canyon to rewild them. This pilot, I looked him up on Google the night before our flight and was disconcerted. The first thing that came up was a story about his losing first one engine and then the other when he was flying up in the mountains, and he had to crash land on a highway up in the mountains. And I realized that nothing like that could possibly happen to us, because the plane that he was taking us up in had only one engine, as I had also looked out. It also has these great big sausage tires, which he explained make it easy to crash land in very short areas. So I felt that I was in very good hands. We flew so close to mountains that it felt almost like the wings were gonna scrape against them. This was just going up outside of Boulder, up into the Rockies. But we didn't. I had to hand him his oxygen at one point because we were high enough that he said, you ask people to count backwards from 100 by sevens and they find that they can't do it, even though they don't think they're having oxygen deprivation problems. But he was required by law to breathe some oxygen, so I was happy to give it to him. This, you see that thing that's cutting across these are the Never Summer Mountains, and you see that what looks like a road going across. It's actually an aqueduct that even predates the New York City's water system, the water pipes. That was begun in the late 1800s, and it was to carry water from the other side of the Continental Divide to the Eastern Plains, where even in the 1800s, farmers didn't have enough water. It was built mostly by Japanese labor. They were just using picks and black powder. And like the New York City water tunnels, it flows entirely by gravity, and it carries water from, it doesn't tap the Colorado River directly, but it like a gash in a rubber tree, it catches water that's flowing down the slopes that would flow into the Colorado or its tributaries, and then carries it into a stream, which then carries it to the other side of the mountains. This photograph actually explains why that system exists. These are clouds that are storm systems that are coming from the west, traveling east across the country and piling up over the Rocky Mountains. 85% of the population of Colorado exists in Denver, Boulder, Colorado Springs, Pueblo, or Pueblo, as they call it there. In cities on the Front Range, which are in what's called the rain shadow of the Rockies, the rain doesn't get that far. It comes to the edge of the mountains and then falls. So 85% of the state's population is on the east of the mountains, and 80% of the precipitation is to the west. This is Denver, like New York City. It needs water, and that water comes by a number of complicated projects like the one that Emily described, bringing water to New York City. Also, as in New York, in Colorado, people who live on the west of the mountains are perpetually angry at people who live on the east because they think of them that they're stealing their water. In fact, the same is true of what it is in New York. If you took the entire population of New York City and spread it out across the territory that its water comes from at the density of a typical suburban America, all those, the Adirondacks wouldn't exist anymore. The Catskills wouldn't exist. All those little towns would be swallowed up. And so it's places like New York City and Denver that make the wild places possible. And instead of being angry, those people should be down on their knees and thanking residents of big city for taking water from them. It's actually Denver, like it's actually true New York City too. Cities are actually fairly small users of water. The Denver water system uses only about 2% of the water that's used in the state. Most of it, it's true throughout the basin of the Colorado, goes to agriculture. I was at the beginning of my trip, I was interviewing somebody in Eagle, Colorado, and I had to be back in Boulder that evening to go out to dinner with some people. And so I put the address of the restaurant into my navigation app on my phone and was amazed to see that the route that it took me on didn't go on I-70 at all, the big interstate that goes right by Eagle and to the Front Range, but took me up into the mountains along these sort of tiny roads right along the river. And I was thinking, not long before Google Maps had asked me if it wanted to navigate me to if they wanted to navigate me to work, and my office is in my house, and so I didn't know what Google meant. And then I looked at the address I clicked on the icon. The address was 10 Golf Course Road, and realized that Google had, based on how I spend my time during a typical week, Google had decided that I must work at my golf club. And so in the same way, I thought I'd been doing lots of searches about the Colorado River, and I thought maybe Google thinks that I would be interested to drive along the Colorado. And the road kept getting smaller and smaller. It got down to about the width of a driveway, and I finally realized that I had accidentally clicked the pedestrian icon when I put the address in, and so Google thought that I was on foot. But I didn't regret it, and I was looking down. This is the Colorado River down there. It's not very large. It's 1,000 miles shorter than the Mississippi. The Mississippi carries the entire annual flow of the Colorado River every couple of weeks. And yet, the Colorado is extraordinarily important to a large part of the western United States. It supplies water to nearly 40 million people. It irrigates 6 million acres of agriculture. And much of that irrigated land, it created itself, basically with what's missing from the Grand Canyon. It's spread out across Arizona and Southern California, creating this extraordinarily deep and arable soil. So I was able to look down on it from up here and to see at first hand what I had looked at from the plane the day before. When I got a little farther west from there, in Western Colorado, there's a sequence of towns. I can't remember the exact orders. Rifle, Parachute, Silt. There's a series of them. And near Rifle, this is taken near Rifle. The Colorado River is just out of view right here. In the late 1950s, when the United States was no longer dropping nuclear weapons on anybody and had an extraordinary surplus of them, there was created a program called Project Plowshare to come up with peaceful applications for the nation's surplus nuclear weapons. And there were many people, there were lots of ideas. The Atomic Energy Commission had some, and then other people would propose them, possible uses for nuclear weapons. Some ideas were creating subterranean water reservoirs in the West, replacing the Panama Canal by exploding atom bombs across the Isthmus of Panama to create a new canal. There was a similar proposal on Cape Cod to create a second Cape Cod canal across the Cape by using atom bombs. It seemed like a quick and easy way to do a lot of heavy excavation. Lake Tahoe had a garbage problem, and they thought that maybe they could explode a few nuclear weapons down underground below Lake Tahoe, and then they could dump all their garbage down into the cavity that it would create. There was a proposal to deepen the Bering Strait so that ships would be able to get through more easily. There were lots and lots and lots of proposals like these. And then there were some that, most of them nobody did anything about, but some of them were done. And one of them was to increase the efficiency of hydraulic fracturing, which was, even then in the 1960s was how natural gas was mined, if extracted. And the idea was to the Atomic Energy Commission would drill a hole down more than a mile and put 40 kilotons worth of surplus nuclear weapons in and blow them up and free up all the natural gas. And they actually did it. In 1969, 3 weeks after Woodstock, the control people were here. This was Ground Zero, where the explosion took place 6,000 feet down. And what they discovered is what you think they probably could have discovered before they did it, which was that although it freed up a certain amount of natural gas, it was all radioactive and they couldn't do anything with it. But you can, if you, it's called Project Rulison, and if you look it up online, you can find the coordinates, the latitude and longitude, which I did, and then I drove to try to find the site. And this, I didn't take this picture because I chickened out about 200 yards away from it. There were no trespassing signs. They got more and more dire, and they had bigger and bigger caliber bullet holes in them from, you know, people just driving around and recreationally shooting holes in signs. And I finally turned around and went back, but I got pretty close. There's still a lot of natural gas in that area. This is right along the Colorado. You can see the Colorado going through there. And all the places that look like sort of prepared building sites for suburban houses are actually fracking sites. Those are all, it's where our New York City's electricity comes from. Here's the Colorado in the same area. This is, as you can see, this is about as wide as the Colorado gets when it's not dammed up behind Hoover Dam or Glen Canyon Dam. It's a pretty modest river all the way from beginning to end. This is just past the Rulison atomic site where they look for natural gas. This is the Grand Valley. It's the first major irrigated area. The Colorado River goes right through here. Settlers who lived there began irrigating in the 1800s, first by carrying water in barrels from the river, and then by building a ditch system. You can see a ditch, a canal that carries water from the river around there and delivers it around. This is what the land looked like before it was irrigated, and this is what it looks like with irrigation. This was a vineyard that I visited. This is one of the irrigation canals. Oops. Every water user has what's called a head gate, which is like a faucet that you turn on that draws water from the canal, allows it to flow into pipes like this and into little trenches that carry it through the vineyard, which is what this one does. And grapes and peaches and pears are major agricultural products of produce of the Grand Valley. But the main function of all those agricultural products is mostly to draw tourists to that area. And so the vineyard that I visited, the woman who is the co-owner of it with her husband explained that they grow some grapes, but mostly they buy grapes. And the economic mainstay of their vineyard is actually their tasting room, which is open 7 days a week all year long, and where people come to drink wine that they haven't necessarily made on their same vineyard. Well, I'll skip over the Grand Canyon, which I assume that everybody can picture. The Grand Canyon is one of the greatest works of the Colorado River. It carved it out, and it didn't carve it out the way people sometimes imagine by eating its way down through. The terrain was actually rising slowly as the river was flowing across it. So it was a joint effort between the water and the rising terrain. As the along the Colorado, water is drawn off by what in the West are called projects. So it's always a dam or a canal or an irrigation system, and often all of them together. One of the largest projects is the All-American Canal, the Imperial Irrigation District project. The Imperial Valley in Southern California is the largest single user of Colorado River water. and uses it to. This is the All-American Canal, which is the canal that draws water from the Colorado River and takes it to the Imperial Valley. And at this point, it's actually larger than the river is. This is what the Imperial Valley looks like without irrigation water. You can see the All-American Canal down here at the bottom, crossing it, carrying water 30 miles from the Colorado to this, to the Imperial Valley. And if anybody here who eats fruits or vegetables during the winter and still to this time of the year eats produce from the Imperial Valley or from the Mexicali Valley, which is just over the border into Mexico right here, at least for the time being until we stop being able to buy produce from Mexico. I visited a farmer in This is Larry Cox, who's a farmer in the Imperial Valley. He farms about 3,000 acres in California and some in Mexico as well. The soil that you see here is soil that, as I said, used to be in the Grand Canyon. It's what's missing from the Grand Canyon. When I arrived to meet Larry, it rained a little bit the night before, and California was in drought, and I said that maybe I deserve some credit for bringing rain to Southern California. And he said, we don't like rain. We don't plan for rain because rain throws them off. And this is his onion schedule or lettuce schedule, one of them. And because their weather is pretty much 100% predictable, he knows when he's gonna plant, what he's gonna plant. He knows the day that they will harvest it. He knows the day that they'll thin their lettuce plants. Here they are. He knows everything to the day when it's going to happen. And because the temperature never drops very low, they are able to grow multiple crops during the year. They get more than one harvest out of a field. The most of the fields in the Imperial Valley are flood irrigated. This is a drainage ditch. The water is allowed to flow into a field until it gets to the other side, and then it flows into basically the drainage system, like going down the drain in a shower. And it's a necessary step in irrigation in that part of the world, partly because the water in the Colorado River is salty to begin with and becomes saltier as it moves down through the seven states that it passes through. And then it picks up more salt from the ground, and in order to keep the salt from building up in the soil, you have to constantly be flushing it through. And then you need a place to put it. This is the Salton Sea in Southern California. This is the Imperial Valley Agricultural Area. Anybody who knows anybody at Coachella, they're right up there right now at the other end of the Salton Sea. The Salton Sea is the largest wetland in California. It's the largest body of water. It's about 350 acres. And it's what the Imperial Valley drains into. It's also the product of an amazing engineering and environmental disaster. In the early 1900s, the first farmers in the Imperial Valley were trying to get more water into their irrigation system, and they made a cut in the side of the canal that diverted water from the Colorado River. And they did it poorly, and for almost 2 years, the entire volume of the Colorado River flowed into what had been a big, like Death Valley-like hole called the Salton Sink, which over the eons had contained the Colorado periodically flows into it, and then it changes course, and the Salton Sink dries up. But for 2 years, the Colorado flowed into it before they were finally able to get it back into its channel, and it created the Salton Sea, which is simultaneously an extraordinary environmental disaster and at the same time an amazing environmental asset. For a period after the 1920s, mostly the 1940s, 1950s, 1960s, the Salton Sea was going to be the next Lake Tahoe. The Beach Boys and the Marx Brothers had boats there. Lots of people. It was Guy Lombardo, the band leader Guy Lombardo, raced boats on it and set a speedboat record. There were so many water skiers that they had to build enormous boat ramps to get all the boats into the water. And it was the scene of a huge real estate bubble, I guess you would say. You can still buy real estate there now, probably for the money that you have in your pocket. This is outside the beach club, the North Shore Beach Club, and you can see that underneath the word lots there, you can see the word motel. There was a motel there that's not there any longer. This is where the Beach Boys used to tie up their boats. There's a Linkin Park CD in which they're standing right there, and you can, if you have it on the cover, you can see it. This is the beach at the Salton Sea. The water in the Salton Sea, it's called what's called an endoheric lake, which is, it has water flows into it mainly from runoff from the Imperial Valley, but nothing flows out. There's no outlet. The only outlet is evaporation. So the water steadily becomes saltier and saltier. It's significantly saltier than the Pacific Ocean, and it also contains a sort of accumulation of all the stuff that people put on, the breakdown products of DDT, selenium, all kinds of agricultural chemicals and breakdown products, and then also just chemicals that are in the soil in that whole, along the whole course of the Colorado. And as a result, at the time when the Salton Sea was a major resort area, the sea had been stocked with many different kinds of sports fish, and fishermen would go there to fish. Now it's only the tilapia that can survive, and they're at the very, very limit of what they can tolerate. It's a pretty place. That's the southern end of the Salton Sea. There's some. It's a major stop on the North American flyway. What birds that fly up, something like 400 species of birds that fly up the West Coast, pass over there or stop there. And despite the saltiness of the water, they find things to eat. This is the Sonny Bono Salton Sea National Wildlife Refuge, because before he crashed into a tree and died, unfortunately, he was one of the, in Congress, he was a great proponent of doing something about the Salton Sea, which has become an issue that's become especially urgent at the moment, because as California is trying to save water, the farmers in the Imperial Valley are perforce having to become more efficient. As a result, there's less runoff that's running off of their land, and the Salton Sea is shrinking. If there's no, the Salton Sea until a few years ago received about 1 million acre feet of water a year in runoff from agriculture, which is 2 million Olympic swimming pools, Olympic-sized swimming pools, and that will be, within the next few years, that'll be cut in half, and as that amount goes down, the lake shrinks. As it shrinks, it exposes more of the lake bed, which is all salt and selenium and all those dead fish and all the stuff that killed all the things that were in the water, and then it becomes a threat to all the people who live in the airshed of the Salton Sea, including parts of metropolitan Los Angeles. So there are a number of fairly urgent programs to try to figure out how to keep the bottom of the Salton Sea from blowing onto Los Angeles. And there's some ideas, but it's an extraordinarily expensive prospect. And the first thing that people always mention, let's build a pipeline through the mountains to the Pacific Ocean and bring in water from the Pacific. It wouldn't work for complicated reasons that we can go into later if you want to, but it wouldn't work. So forget it. This is cotton growing. This is actually in Arizona. And this is this cotton represents one of the challenges in thinking about water in the West, which is that it seems ridiculous, or so it seemed to me, to think that you would move water 300 miles from the Colorado River into southern Arizona in order to grow cotton in a desert. On the other hand, in fact, Arizona doesn't grow as much cotton as it used to. Its cotton production peaked in the 1950s, and it's now only about 15% of what it was then. But on the other hand, most of the cotton, the world's cotton right now, is grown in places like China and Brazil and Pakistan, which have even worse water problems than the United States does. And so the question is, does it make sense for cotton to be grown in those places that have more serious environmental problems than the American West does? Or should we maybe not be wearing clothes made of cotton at all? Should we be wearing just all Under Armour and Nike yoga pants, which are made from fossil fuels? As I say in a book, I don't have an answer to that question, but it's the type of question that we face on any number of environmental issues. There's no good answer to it. Maybe it's better to wear fossil fuels than to burn them up, or maybe it's better to grow cotton in Arizona than it is to grow it in China, where who knows what they're doing. This is a national water expert who I played golf with about 5 years ago. He's now unfortunately the president of the United States, but. At the time, he wasn't, and nobody imagined at that time that he would be. But I talked to him when he had just declared as a candidate, and he said, you know, I'm number two in the polls. And I said, I know. I said, that's frightening. But I said, I hope you don't drop out before the first Republican debate, because I really want to see you on TV with those guys. Little did I know. But anyway, we talked a little bit about water. It was a foreshadowing of what we see now every day, which is, I asked him about some of his golf courses in California, and if they had, we had been talking about golf, and if he had water problems there. And he said, you know, all you have to do to solve California water problems is build a pipeline down from the north, from Washington State or from Oregon, from the Cascades, just pipe water down. And I said, well, it would have to be a big pipe. And he said, no, not that big. They got nothing but water up there. And then he said, or you could do that thing with the ocean, which I said, desalination? He said, yeah, desalination. He said, which gets expensive, by the way. So anyway, he's on top of those issues too. when we played golf together, I wrote about a round of golf that we played in Golf Digest. And he was very angry when it came out. And it turned out that he called me. I was standing in the cemetery at Trinity Church, and he called me on my cell phone. He was yelling at me. He was upset with the article. And he was not upset because I had said that he had asked two little 10-year-old girls if they wanted to be supermodels when they grow up, as he had. And he wasn't upset because the art department had created an illustration. It was a golf ball wearing a sort of a turf toupee that looked like his hair. And he wasn't upset that I had said that he had introduced someone to me as the richest guy in Germany, as he had, or that I described the conversation that he had with Vic Damone, the crooner Vic Damone, who married a woman that he met at Mar-a-Lago when he was performing there, but she had just had a stroke. And Trump had told me that she was worth $900 million. And when we ran into Damone in the locker room, Trump said, by way of brotherly compassion, said that if Damone wanted him to appear as a character witness for him, if her children tried to cut him out of her will, he would be happy to do that. So, but what he was mad at me about was that I had not said that he had shot 71, which is a very good golf score, one under par, when we played. And the reason we hadn't was that he hadn't. And I don't know what he shot. We were just a friendly round. We were giving each other putts. But he really wanted that number, and he was really upset. So I wrote about this in a Japanese, when Prime Minister Abe was over here to play golf with Trump, they sent a news crew from a Japanese news program, came to talk to me and asked me, what they mainly wanted to know was about, first, how far he hits his driver, but then also about what did he shoot, what was his score, what did he really shoot? And I said I didn't know, but anyway, in Japan, they found a guy who played with him and had kept the scorecard, and that day, he had shot 89. And so the on this completely from another planet news show, that was the lead story, and that's what that was about. In the early days of the of what's now the United States Bureau of Reclamation, which is the federal body that deals with all these water projects in the West, it was called the United States Reclamation Service, and the Reclamation Service had a four-armed logo that they came up with based on an Indian something that they saw in India, and yes, it United States Reclamation Service. This is on a bridge at Laguna Dam, just this side of the Mexican border, and you can probably guess just about the exact year that the U.S. Reclamation Service stopped using that as their logo. But that bridge is still there; you can see it. And this was the flag of the U.S. Reclamation Service. You can see there. This is from the 1930s, and it looks like the dust jacket of a Philip Roth novel, but it was actually the logo of a federal agency, but no longer. Anyway, if you have any questions, I'm sure Emily can answer them. I think in the West, the answer, it's actually true with energy too. Somehow we have to bring down our total consumption. It's not enough to just get better at what we use. And I think the easiest strategy, the one that people like the best is always, let's just get more efficient at what we do. Let's get more miles to the gallon. Let's get more dollar value from every gallon of water. But unless you address the problem from the top, and you can see it very clearly in the West with the Colorado, the Colorado River was divided up in the 1920s by the states that border it, and it happened to be too bad for everybody. It was like the wettest period since the 1400s, and so they wildly overestimated how much water was in the river. And they divided up more than all the water that's in it. And so in the West, they talk about the difference between paper water, which is what the water that people have a right to, and then wet water. Which in many ways people are less interested in because it's just actual water. It's not something that you have a legal right to. And so the challenge in the West is to figure out how to bring down people's idea of how much paper water is in the river to something more like the amount of wet water. And since then, since the 1920s, if you look at the agreements that were made in the 1920s, no one mentions anything that anybody today would recognize as an environmental concern. Water was just money. It was liquid money. If it flowed into the sea, it was wasted. It was farming. It was agriculture. It was mining. It was a little bit of industry. There was nothing, not even recreation, no recreation, no sense of its value to species other than us. Environmental issues were all the other way around. It was like, what's the environment doing to us, and how can we stop it? So I think that with water, that's the hard thing. And actually, water is a pretty good model for dealing with environmental issues, because if you don't have water, you die. So people, climate change, you can sort of postpone indefinitely what you do about it, because it's not going to kill you tomorrow. It's going to kill your grandchildren, or it's going to make life difficult for your children, or for sometime in the future. But with water, people run out of water. You know, you have to do something by tomorrow. And so, as a result, there you see it in the West. You see it in other countries. People become much more pragmatic when they're dealing with water issues. And you even see the agreements between Mexico and the United States that have to do with water are much sort of sounder and more rational than a lot of the things that you hear coming out of Washington now. It'll be interesting to see what impact that has, what Washington has now, on this sort of recent history of of pretty reasonable agreements between Mexico and the United States. But water is big, and it's one of the if you look at Syria, for example, Syria, a huge drought. The civil war in Syria was preceded by a huge drought of basically exhausting groundwater, and there was a huge migration from the agricultural areas into the cities. And I think you could probably go back through history and think of all human conflict, or almost all human conflict, is reducible to some kind of resource conflict at some level. It's either people trying to steal resources from somebody else, or people responding to the loss of a resource that they need. So, but I think water is not only. It's easier to be optimistic about water than some more complicated ones, but then I think you can also think that water is maybe a model for how we address some of these other issues.
So is it more policy-based and less about making sure your faucet doesn't leak?
Yeah, it's interesting, and it's with the leakage. Go back a slide. I think this is one of the most interesting slides. This is the All-American Canal. It's called the All-American Canal because the canal that carried water from the Colorado River to the Imperial Valley used to go partly through Mexico, which was the most logical place to go. But Congress wanted a canal that was all in America. So I think it was in the 40s they built the All-American. This goes really very, it's very close to the Mexican border, but it's all in America. A lot of water used to leak because there's just a trench dug through the desert. A lot of water used to leak out, just as it does through the water pipes in the system that feeds New York City. And so one of the ideas that California had for addressing its water problems was to line the All-American Canal, or a big part of it, with concrete to keep that water from leaking out, which they did. And it saved, it's 80,000 acre feet of water, 160,000 Olympic swimming pools. And it seemed like a great savings, but all the water that had leaked out was feeding groundwater in Mexico, just over the border in Mexico, and was supporting agriculture there, and was keeping down the salt content of the groundwater there. So, it wasn't really water that had been saved; it was water that had been that the United States had inadvertently transferred to Mexico and was now inadvertently taking back. One of the interesting things about the way water law works in the West is. The water is all divided up. I shudder to think of explaining any of this, but I think I do a really good job of it in my book. But if Mexico's entitled to 1.5 million acre feet a year, initially the United States wasn't sure that Mexico should get any water from that river, even though it flows through Mexico. But they, in the 1940s, they made an agreement with Mexico, and Mexico gets 1.5 million acre feet a year. Mexico has to order that water. It takes it about 5 days to get from Hoover Dam to the Mexican border. And so if Mexico needs water, they order it, and it's released from Hoover Dam, and it flows down the Colorado into Mexico. If something happens in between there, if there's a rainstorm, if an irrigation system breaks, they can cancel the order. But the water is moving. And if Mexico is not charged for water above order if they haven't ordered it. So if water is coming down, and it hasn't been ordered, and it goes into Mexico anyway, it doesn't count against their 1.5 million acre feet. So what the United States did recently with California, Nevada, and Arizona, I think contributed tens of millions of dollars to it, was they built this, what looks like this square here. It's a reservoir. If water is coming down the Colorado River above order, somebody cancels an order, they can catch it and divert it into here and hold it in the United States so it doesn't cross. So that's another way we've saved water. So I think it depends on what we're talking about when we talk about conservation. It gets really complicated inside houses. There's sort of two different kinds of water. There's what's known as consumed water and non-consumed water. If you live in Las Vegas, 93% of the water that goes down a drain goes into a processing plant and is used again for something. But if water that goes under your yard is called consumed because it goes into the ground and it disappears until it works its way all the way through the hydrologic cycle and comes back at some point as rain. So if you put bricks in your toilet tank inside a house, you're not really saving water from the system, because that's water that's not going back into the system, and you're making it cheaper to yourself to wash your car or to use a consumed use, to put it on your lawn to wash your car with it, which takes the water out of the system. So in Las Vegas, which has some of the most stringent conservation rules in the United States, they don't care if you have low flow stuff. They don't really even want you to have low flow stuff. They want you not to put water into your yard and let everything go down the drain. But so all the rules are about don't wash your car, don't water your lawn. But they would not go to your house and put a brick in your toilet tank. It's one of the sort of paradoxes of water policy is that the source of funds that has made Las Vegas's conservation regulations possible, the source of that funds was connection charges. So when you built a new house, you had to pay a connection charge to get hooked up to the water system. When the population growth of Las Vegas stopped in 2008, all those connection charges went away. And so Las Vegas had these huge projects, including one to tap Lake Mead, and suddenly they had no money. So there too, they were in the where population growth was both the cause and the solution to their problems. There was an episode of The Simpsons where Homer says that alcohol is the both the cause of and the solution to all of life's problems. And it's pretty much the same.
Yes. I have another question. Considering what's been going on in the last few years, like with water as a resource that is being fought over and, lands and so on, I was wondering if you could weigh in on Flint and Standing Rock.
Yeah, I think Emily may know more than that, but there's the whole idea is just like the pipes that carry water to New York. You just keep your fingers crossed. It happened in Arizona. The chief driver of water policy in the West for a long time has been making sure you get yours. So Arizona's focus was on not letting California end up with all the water that it was supposed to have. Arizona was finally able to build, they built a canal, an aqueduct that carried water 300 and some miles east from the Colorado River to Phoenix and Tucson. And then they had, there's a million complications, but one of the consequences was that Tucson was able to switch from using groundwater, which it had basically exhausted the underlying groundwater, to this water from the Colorado River by way of a project called the Central Arizona Project. And when they did that, the water had a different chemistry. It's like water has a chemistry. And it flowed through the pipes in the opposite direction. And so all the crud that had accumulated on the inside of the pipes, like this protective effect, and like in Flint, it all came out. And people turned on the tap and it would be brown. And it took a couple of years for Tucson, the government of Tucson and the state, to make people confident to drink that water. It's just when you think about, I've talked to people, doing excavation in New York, and they still turn up those wooden water pipes. They're still down there.
And the Flint thing was very solvable. I mean, it was very preventable. And it was just the city wanted to save some money by switching sources. And all they needed to do was raise the pH levels of the water so that it didn't corrode the pipes. And that, when I talked to, the water experts here in the DEP, I mean, everybody was sort of shaking their head. It was not a very complicated and it was an extremely preventable situation, which is what makes it so frustrating. So, but you also have, aging water systems throughout the country. I mean, this is something that, not every city prioritizes. And so you have, if you look at the American Society for Civil Engineers, is that the right? Yeah, they put out a report card every year about infrastructure, and our water infrastructure consistently gets sort of low marks. So we're pretty lucky here in New York that so much attention is paid to the water system. Yeah, now. I mean, who knows?
I live in a little town in Connecticut that where most of the residents get water from wells, but we have two little water companies that are more than 100 years old, and they've merged. But a friend of mine used to serve as a pro bono lawyer for one of the water companies, and at some state hearing with the department, the environmental department, he was asked, you know, what's your monitoring system? And he said, well, when Mrs. Eames can't get water in her upstairs bathroom, we know that we have to go clean out the spring. And they hired the sanitation officer was a guy that they hired to use a net to fish mouse carcasses out of the spring, and he was paid by the carcass, so you would think that there was maybe. But they just recently dug up the water the supply pipes, and I'm sure they were beautiful iron supply pipes when they started, and it looked like what I'm sure my arteries look like. It was the total, you know, it had gone from this to like just the width of a finger, and this beautiful, they look like geodes, this beautiful rust accumulations. And I think all over, who knows where anybody has,
Yes, so New York City is known for being one of the cities to have cleanest tap water. It's just wondering how safe is it really?
Oh, it's very safe. You know, as I mentioned, you know, they're constantly conducting tests, and both, you know, even all the way up to the little streams where, you know, in the Catskill Mountains, you know, they're dipping in probes and they're, you know, collecting samples and then they're testing it downstream here in the city, and even when at the little sampling stations, they're not just testing one station. They're also, you know, if they notice something, they'll check the, you know, station, you know, one above it and one below it. And so they are really easily able to identify if there is some kind of outbreak of E. coli or something. And so, yeah, and if you are concerned about your water, though, the New York City, you can order on 311 a free lead testing kit. So if you know, and that's made available to anyone who lives here. But yeah, I mean, we have the champagne of drinking water. That's what they call it.
It is very good. It's like the best water.
It's the best.
Way better than my well water, which I think is probably poison. For sort of in this part of the country, there's in New England, there's kind of a stealth drought going on now, which people don't even necessarily know, but I know lots of people. It's true up through sort of central Connecticut and up in Massachusetts and up into New Hampshire or Vermont, where people's wells are going dry. And it's because we've had a couple of really dry years. We've got a lot of rain right now, but groundwater is the sort of the great ticking time bomb of water. It's never the law regarding groundwater is different from the law in most places regarding surface water, because just you can't see it, and so there are lots of places where we don't even know what's left. And if my well goes dry, I can dig another well. Or if I dry up my neighbor's well, my neighbor has no recourse, and I've had neighbors ominously drilling wells around my house. So I may have to go poison them or something. And they're drilling them too to water their ridiculous lawns. So, but keep your eye on groundwater. That's where the trouble is. Yes.
Hearing about like all the water being sort of diverted from mountains and all these sorts of things, have there been sort of big ecological impacts, like in the places where it's from?
Oh yeah, you know, the Colorado River isn't really a river anymore. It's like a 1,400 mile long canal. The flow is controlled. There's basically the federal hand on the faucet. You can have sort of flood events, but nothing like, you know, in the old days when the river was unconstrained, when there were no dams on the river, there would be these the torrents of water flowing down. Like if you read about John Wesley Powell, the difference between low water and high water on the sides of a canyon could be 100 feet of just this river, you know, and that doesn't happen anymore. as a consequence, all the things that that flowing water used to do, the way it would reconfigure, the way it would wipe out certain plants and make it possible for others, would restore others, none of that happens anymore. And as a consequence, the whole across the whole Colorado Basin, there's a, you know, it's a species, it's a tamarisk or salt cedar. It's a plant that was imported as an ornamental from Asia at some point, and it's completely taken over. It can survive in salty soil. It draws the salt up into it and then it excretes it through the stomata in its leaves. And I tasted one. And then there was this sort of white efflorescence on the ground below it. I was going to taste that too, but the environmentalist I was with said, "No, I think that's just bird poop. So don't taste that." But birds won't nest in it. They'll sit in it, but they won't nest in it. They don't feed on it, and it rapidly takes over everything else. There's a tiny mussel. It's like the zebra mussel, but that has spread in 20 years from the Great Lakes to Mexico and across. And it has no no predators in any ecosystem. And people are always trying things like what they always try with the tamarisk. There's a beetle that's also from Asia that eats only salt cedar, eats tamarisk. And so lots of that has been imported with the sort of consequences that you can imagine, where now it's a problem. And so we have to import something else to eat only it. there may not be anything one step up the food chain from it. Yeah, there are lots of environmental consequences, but at the same time, there's almost 40 million people that depend on it. Some of them in cities. Las Vegas is the closest city to the Colorado River, at 30 miles away. But Los Angeles is 250. Phoenix is 300 and plus. One thing I hadn't realized, and I know some people here are from Los Angeles, it never occurred to me until I was working on this book. I've always been envious of like people who lived in L.A. and they go out into your yard and pull a lime from your lime tree for your gin and tonic, or the beautiful flowers that grow around and the beautiful palm trees. None of those plants are indigenous. Los Angeles is desert. Without irrigation, none of those things exist. It would be blowing sand and scrub. So that water from that river has, it's formed, what we think of as what that whole part of the country looks like. Downtown Denver, Aspen, Colorado, the beautiful parks with trees, all that's just from a 19th century irrigation system that still runs as like a network through that town. Everybody's lawn, everybody's flowers, all the trees. It would just be high desert without it. So we make very good use of that water. We use it very efficiently, but that has environmental consequences too.